Okay. I'm very happy that we have been able to invite Marie Lorenz, Delta Lima 5 MLO, Mike Lima, Oscar, from AMSAT. And one of the major events of the past year was the launch of the S-Hailsat from Qatar, the first geostationary amateur radio satellite, which is a real milestone in space technology, whatever we have up there. It's really fantastic that we have this satellite now. And I've been working the satellite myself, and in fact my first QSO was of course with an SDR, but I was doing CW on it. But that was really cool. Okay. The QO-100 S-Hailsat satellite is an almost entirely software-defined radio topic, because there are no transmitters that you can use for the satellite. So for that reason, it is absolutely great that we have a representative from AMSAT. And of course, Mario is an old known friend. He has been referring here before in the SDRA. So, please give a warm applause to Marie Lorenz.
Thank you. Okay, so thanks for the introduction. I am here today, as the title promises, to say something about the ground station design of the official ground stations for the S-Hailsat 2 or Qatar Oscar 100 satellites. When I say official, that means I don't refer to any ground station that any of you as an amateur would want to set up, because I cannot, well, do anything about that except giving some good tips. The thing is, we have a set of official ground stations, and they are themselves also SDR based. And they have, or they fulfill a couple of functions, and this is basically what I'm going to discuss in this presentation. First, one slide about who is AMSAT DL in this case. AMSAT DL is a group of amateur or radio amateur enthusiasts that now exist for 50 years. Both AMSAT, the original American one, and the German, I would not say subsidiary, but we founded basically our own organization here, and we've been working closely together with the American AMSAT in a couple of highly elliptical orbit projects, basically all over the 80s, and they are very well known to most of the radio amateurs in the satellite, or with interest in satellites, which is basically the P3 series with P3 B, C, and D, also known as Oscar 10, 13, and 40, which were the satellites that have been here for quite some, have been available for quite some years before they went out of service. And were the first satellites to bridge large distances because of the highly elliptical orbit that they had. So that's basically the organization that I am affiliated with today. I'm affiliated with some other organizations, but they do not matter here at this moment. S-Hailsat, here is an old PR photo, basically from when it was planned, is a geostationary spacecraft from, S-Hailsat is the company in Qatar, and it's basically a TV communications satellite, and we have an amateur radio payload hosted on this satellite. And this is basically an S-band to X-band transmitter. That means we have an uplink at 2.4 gigahertz and a downlink at 10.5. And it's a linear transponder, so we can do anything we want on this satellite in terms of allowable modes. With the downside, of course, there is no hardware directly on the spacecraft, so we cannot do any, regenerative processing, which is nice, but maybe we can do that next time. The basic, one of the main reason for that is that also the transponder was completely built integrated by the commercial satellite developers. Like in the past, the satellites, we had built them on our own, but since this is a commercial satellite, it's a multi-million dollar project, the SHALESAT people said we want to have everything from one company completely integrated, and so this basically is also a reason on if something goes wrong, who's to blame, because if it's our satellite, the worst thing that can happen, our satellite dies. Here it's the worst thing, this would be that such a geostationary communication satellite dies, which is a completely different amount of damage that could be done, however unlikely, but not impossible. So this was we basically only have a transparent transponder there and do not have our own hardware on the satellite, and this is also part of the following talk or the necessities that make the official ground stations necessary. Timeline, the idea came up in 2012, so satellite projects typically run at a little slower pace than other projects do, especially SDR-based projects, they typically run very fast. So the idea came up, the detailed idea came up in 2012, some initial talks and some ideas about this had been discussed even years earlier. The official kickoff meeting with Melco, who built the satellite, were in 2014. As already has been said, and as most people probably know, it has been launched last November, and we have transponder availability since this February. So starting this February, we have geostationary coverage over most of Europe, Africa, parts of South America, large swaths of Asia, but of course we can only cover roughly a third of the Earth, so there would be room for two more amateur radio satellites if someone here could take the hint. Here is the third of the Earth that we can cover at this time, and you can see we cover most of the old continents. Unfortunately, Australia is not covered. We only cover half of South America, and North America, unfortunately, is out as well. Now, in terms of transponders, we actually have two transponders on this spacecraft. And these transponders are basically run on backup amplifiers of the main payload. So the thing is, if for whatever reason more than the otherwise available spare amplifier tubes on the satellite for the main commercial transponders should die, that might mean that we have to give up one or even both of our transponders. So we right now have two transponders. One of these transponders is what we call the wideband transponder. It's an 8 megahertz wide transponder that is being used for DATV, digital ATV. So if you walk by the AMSAT booth at the exhibition, we've got the camera there. You can be live broadcast in video all over the coverage area that we've just seen in the last slide. So which I think is also something completely new and not remotely thinkable for radio amateurs before. Now, what you see here is the spectrum of the wideband transponder. It's, as I said, 8 megahertz wide. And the first hump over there is a 2 megasymbol beacon that is transmitted from the ground station in Doha. And it's basically a beacon promo, general purpose video. Many people have seen it. We will in the future get some more content on it, and yeah, that's the thing. Now the remaining space is typically well, it's split into several channels just by convention. For smaller symbol rates, digital ATV modes, and you can see here that there is two OMs, one that is way too strong in terms of power, and the other one that is probably not 100% readable, judging from the power level, because the rule here is as well, a good power level to aim for is the level of the beacon. Now, let's turn to the narrowband transponder, which is the main well, target of the discussion in this talk. The narrowband transponder is a typical transponder for narrowband modes like SSB or CW for, well, general amateur radio usage. So we have 250 kilohertz wide frequency band. The transponder itself is actually a little bit wider for technical reasons, because on a satellite you cannot have high quality Q factor filters, so the filter is not that steep. So the coordinated frequencies for this satellite are the ones that have only this 250 kilohertz bandwidth, and we ask people to work inside this bandwidth. So that is why we placed two beacons on the lower and the upper end of the transponder. And these beacons, they fulfill multiple functions. First of all, is they mark the satellite position. This is very important, or especially if you have traditional satellites with no other like video content going on. Even if you think, for example, LEOs or others, if you do not have any signal from the satellite that is always on, you will not be able to align your antenna to find the satellite. Here, for this spacecraft, it's a little bit different. Since this is a traditional, well, commercial satellite, so you can receive TV programs, and there is also another satellite located at the same orbital position, so you can use that to align your antennas. But even then, opportunity to align the antenna is really, well, different depending on where you are, because they use spot beams for the with specific beams over the Arabic-speaking countries, and there are signals that you cannot receive here in Europe anymore, because they are basically beamed over Africa. So the best bet is to use the amateur radio beacons, put a spectrum analyzer there for the band. The other big benefit is there is no other commercial satellite transmitting down at 10.5 gigahertz where we are transmitting. So it does not happen that you inadvertently tune to Astra or any of the other birds that are up there. So it's very important to have a beacon that's always on, and it's used for antenna alignment. Second important thing is we have to mark the satellite frequencies. In our case, we mark the begin and the end of the passband. On a real satellite, if you had everything done on a satellite, you might have some frequency drift because of the oscillators on the satellite are not necessarily frequency locked. This is not the case here, but nevertheless, you need the frequency that you can work with. And the next thing is we have to mark some other nominal operation parameters, and that is mainly the transmit power. Users like to transmit with high power if they have it, and that is unfair on an amateur radio satellite because you are taking away the total satellite power, total satellite resources from other users, and this should be prevented. Now, the remaining thing is, if you have your own satellite on this beacon, you typically would want to transmit telemetry information about the health of your spacecraft. This has been traditionally done, again, since it's not our spacecraft and we don't have any hardware in orbit, there is no telemetry from the spacecraft that we can transmit. So what we transmit is a little bit of, telemetry from the ground station itself, which is admittedly rather boring. So yeah, what can I say? The main point is, as I've said several times now, we have no hardware directly on the spacecraft. So these beacons have to be created and transmitted on Earth, on the ground, like any other signal, and they will be transmitted uplinked to the satellite and then downlinked from the satellite like anything else before. This has, of course, some disadvantages, mainly that the beacon content is somewhat boring because there's more interesting thing going on a satellite. It also has the advantage that you can do changes, you can easily update the software and do any things. So if you do an SDR platform, that also has some benefits. But it's just to reiterate, these beacons are created from the ground, and they are basically created then by a software-defined radio system, which is the one that I am talking about in this presentation. Now, the lower beacon is a CW beacon. There is not too much to say about it. The upper beacon is more interesting. It's a PSK beacon. And after some discussion, we have decided to use the traditional 400 bits per second BPSK data format that we have been using on all of our P3 satellites. So this is a design basically from the late 70s in its uncoded form. Phil Kahn, K9Q, in 2000 or 2001 for AO40 added FEC, that is a forward error correction with some coding to it to make it receivable in not that good conditions. I have implemented that as well. So the beacon transmits uncoded traditional frames and these FEC frames in alternation. The reason why this has been done is mostly for nostalgic purposes. There's many people in the AMSAT field, older people that congratulated us on being able to hear the distinctive sound of the 400-bit beacon from orbit again, that they have devoted years of their life when they developed the P3 satellites. The other thing is this format is really robust. It's well known and proven and easy to decode. If they could do this with the the typical thing was part hardware and part Atari 800s in the 80s and 90s, then it certainly is easy to do with PCs nowadays. And the The software that has been developed in around 2000 for AO40 also still is available and is running and working. So we had already the infrastructure there, and since we did not need anything more special, we have just re-implemented that old beacon format. We do know that with newer FEC formats like TurboCodes or LDPC, and even proper pulse shaping, there might be a few dBs of improvement doable. We are contemplating on implementing that. However, time kind of caught up with us, because we had proposed even in the design of these ground stations that all of these ground stations and the beacon signal and everything should be exactly frequency locked to GPS, so the beacon is at a very well-known frequency. And that means that the major application of the PSK upper beacon today is most likely that of a reference beacon used for the many OMs that use SDR console to receive and transmit and work over the spacecraft, because it's this piece of SDR software that was first to have a working implementation. I was also working on it, but well, Simon bit me to it. That had the capability of locking all the receive band to this beacon and therefore enable the usage of very cheap unmodified LNBs and a cheap RTL stick to receive this spacecraft. I think this spacecraft is about the most easiest receivable spacecraft ever, even beating the so-called EasySat FM LEOs, because here you don't have to deal with antenna tracking, and you can still basically use a cheap LNB. The cheapest one that I've seen is €2 and something at one of the it's Pollen, so anyone here knows, but I have been told that they sold out this particular thing, and it was also one of the actually most stable LNBs that I have tested. So you use that and you have a real cheap SDR based receive and transmit system for working on the OSCAR 100. Now, we can of course up this one. Again, this has been part of the original design. I know of a Dutch amateur who has been working on this. Normally, when you do this reference locking, you can only lock the receive frequency. You cannot lock the transmit frequency because you do not know if the offset that you measure has been caused by the LNB or by your SDR hardware. Now, the thing is, what you can, however, measure is the difference in frequency between the upper and the lower beacon. This is a 250 kilohertz nominal frequency difference. And I do know from the efforts of said Dutch OM, because a couple days after we had the spacecraft operational, I get an email telling me he's got a problem, or he thinks he's got a problem, because the frequency is like 4 hertz off. And I had to double check the code, and I found yes, indeed, it's really like 4 hertz off because of rounding in the DDS implementation that generates the two beacons. So if you were to implement this, the nominal spacing between the center frequency of the PSK beacon and the CW beacon is not 250 kilohertz, it's only 249.99609 and so on. Just in case of information, I have been thinking on if maybe I might be changing this in one of the next revisions, but this is a little bit more difficult than or initially thought. Third thing is we've got Lila. Lila is an acronym. It stands for Leistungslimit Anzeiger. It's a power limit indicator. So her job is essentially to inform OMs that transmit over the spacecraft with too much power. And this is an aid especially for users without an SDR. Nowadays, many people have an SDR, so it's easy to monitor your own transmission in relation to the beacon, so it's easy to tell whether you have enough power. If you do not have an SDR, if you have a traditional radio, this is way more difficult because you have to tune here and then you tune there and you have to guess, okay, this sounds with about the same signal strength depending on how loud you whistle and so on. Lila is here for the people that use too much power and to inform them of the fact, because if you use too much power, you might ruin things for other amateurs, either by limiting their capabilities, and also if the power is too high, we get messages from the SHALESAT control center telling us that they have alarms on too high input powers and so on, and so something would have to be done about that in this case. Now technically, Lila is what many SDRs do as well, basically a frequency domain display over the transponder, actually over a little bit more than the transponder, so I'm covering a wider space, and it's monitoring the level of all the amateurs in there, and if they hit a certain level, then the alarm will be triggered. The functionalities of the beacon and of Lila, as I said, are created in ground stations, and we have built four of those. Two of them are in the SHALESAT Satellite Control Center near Doha. One of them is at the Qatar Amateur Radio Society in Doha. And the fourth one is in Bochum with AMSAT-DL. The Bochum one is the one that has been on duty for the last half a year because of some things that were not quite finished at the SCC one, because SHALE built a completely new satellite control center in the middle of the desert for this satellite, so not everything was in place when the hardware was supposed to be installed. So this will have to be done basically or finished at a later time. The hardware that we use to create the beacons and to run Lila on is based on an old friend here, and that is basically the Red Pitaya. However, since this is microwave, we cannot do completely without super heterodyning. And in this case, we have had a modem developed by Achim. It's an IQ modem, so modulator demodulator, based on several analog devices parts, where we can basically transmit on any frequency between 700 and 2000, I think several hundred megahertz. And receive basically also on a rather wide frequency band. The reason for doing that is that we had several different IF frequencies to deal with. In the SCC, they used commercial equipment and they had L-band IF frequencies at 1,300 or something like this megahertz, and in QARS and in AMSAT-DL, we transmit directly on the 2.4 gigahertz, so we generate the 2.4 gigahertz already here. So we needed this wide frequency front end. And the big trick is that well trick the big design requirement from the beginning was that everything, not only the modem but also the Red Pitaya, was locked to an external reference. This was accomplished by removing, there's just some solder bridges that you can set. Basically, you can remove the internal crystal oscillator and then supply the clock frequency from an external system, which again was developed by Achim and provides the 125 megahertz that synchronizes the Red Pitaya. So everything here is GPS locked, and that's basically what gives the stability to all the other users that basically then lock on the beacon. Here's a view on the box, basically from top to the inside. This is it's not the final model, it's an early engineering model, but you can clearly see the Red Pitaya here on the right hand side. The PCB that you see in the middle is this IQ modem from Achim. On the top here is basically a display. This is a Raspberry Pi and an RTL SDR style dongle just to have a backup frequency display and a user interface. And the rest that you see here is up and down converters for a traditional radio, because we had traditional radios there also for testing purposes. So we needed the up and down converters for these so that they are also on the correct frequency. Then you have reference distribution, power supply to the left. Yeah, that's basically the box that we've built four times and installed in these ground stations. Now the Lila or general station or general software system itself is based on the Red Pitaya, also called STEMLab. And this is basically a very interesting piece of hardware, which you know. And the idea is, or the feature is, it's got software, because you can it has two ARM cores where you can run traditional software directly on it, and it also has a sync FPGA where you can run additional hardware things directly in hardware. So we had an initial version where we've done everything in software with the original Red Pitaya FPGA design, and we got it working, everything nice, but we used almost 100% of the CPU on both CPU cores, and since we still had a year before the spacecraft actually launched, I came up with a new idea to get most of the stuff moved into the FPGA. So this is basically an FPGA firmware design based in good parts of Pavel Demin's work, which are also most of the other SDR projects that you know are based upon. But he's got some IP core blocks that are very useful to run here. I have here the schematics from the FPGA software. They are difficult to read, so I will skip them here and just go to the overview schematic that I have here. And what you can see is basically the more or less traditional design, but now also in an FPGA. You have the AD interface for receive. We are using both channels in an IQ configuration, so we have to correct for the typical IQ impairments in terms of gain and phase. We then downmix this in the frequency ranges that we need, and then decimate it. For the SDR part, we keep a 384 kilosample stream, which we can then pipe to traditional SDRs for reception. The transmit side is the lower side, is basically the same as the receive side, but in reverse. And then we have the second receive chain, which we have a hardware implemented FFT hardware implemented filter and hardware implemented averager, so that most of the task that that Lila has to do can actually be done in hardware now. Results for all these efforts is we have this Lila hardware designed, working, and in production use, including also Lila. We had quite disciplined users. So we, at the beginning, when we were fine-tuning the spacecraft gains directly, we did not have Lila enabled in the first place, but it's on now. But nevertheless, statistics show that users are quite disciplined. We see approximately 5 Lila activations per day. So I would like that it stays at this level. All the signals are GPS locked, so all users can use this as a GPS frequency reference, technically locking their own reception systems, which is something that makes operating the satellite really easy. And we have seen a significant CPU reduction down to only 50% CPU usage on one core. The main thing is that we still have to generate both beacons on 384 kilo samples for the upper and the lower beacon, and that's still a little bit taxing work for the small ARM cores that are in this Zynq system. We've seen that the Zynq 7 family that's there as an FPGA, if you program it on an FPGA, is a really worthwhile task or project, because you can do a great lot. And newer SDR platforms available now, like the Pluto SDR, they have the same FPGA on it, so they are actually now my preferred platform for SDR work, despite of some shortcomings in the RF. The stability of the oscillator there is not the best, and they use a rectangular LO for mixing, so you have harmonics that are quite significant. But yeah, that's the thing. Future work, we need more content. As I said, the beacons are quite boring, so I'm thinking on what else I could put there in content. Maybe I also change the format to something more CCSDS-like, should give us a couple dB more. And what I am working on planning now is a minimalistic Qatar Oscar 100 setup. Basically, here you see a first design. The idea is that you can receive and transmit with suitable digital modes without a big antenna dish, using basically essentially only the LNB. So that will make a very small package in terms of operating the spacecraft in a handheld environment. The idea is that you can hold it in your hand, point to the spacecraft, have a little pointing indicator there. If you can assume a smartphone nowadays, tells you where to point it. And if you don't have that much gain on the antenna, you have a wide angle, so it's not too problematic to point the antenna. The problem is that the link budget, not 100% is there where I want it yet, so I may have to do some redesign, but that's, as I said, future work on this slide. So see you on Qatar Oscar 100, and any questions?
On the transmit side, could you describe a typical power and antenna setup?
For a regular user? Okay, transmit side, the simplest setup that I have been using is a Pluto SDR, which makes about 1 milliwatt output. And I use this to drive a eBay Chinese 6 euro preamplifier. That gives you about 100 milliwatt output. which I use to drive a modified Wi-Fi Chinese amplifier, which gives you about 2 watts output into a 60 centimeter dish with a helix feed. This taking into account the 150 euro that you have to pay for the Pluto SDR, the other stuff costs five euro. This one amplifier, the other one was 25 euro plus a little bit. So
it's the same dish for the LNB and for the LX.
No, I use a separate feed, but that's an RF design issue. You can use there are designs for dual feeds where you use one dish and you have an S-band transmit antenna, typically patch or helix, and some sort of LNB. But to make things or to keep things simple and to be able to use the commercial LNBs, I use two dishes.
Your 16 kilo channel FFT, how fast could you clock it?
The general clock of the FPGA design was 125 megahertz, so that's what I used, and I did not get any timing constraint warnings or issues inside the FFT, so I believe that this is not at its limit. You should look at the data sheet. The FFT implementation is the standard FFT implementation that comes from Xilinx.
Okay, danke.
Who else? Any more questions? No more questions? Okay, then, Mario, thank you very, very much for this very, very interesting talk.